Our next speakers are Massimiliano Incuditni and
Yes.
Francesco Di Marcantonio, right?
Yes,
Great.
thank you.
So they are joining us from Italy, and they will tell us about quantum adventure seeker with the kernels, a software framework to speed up the research in quantum machine learning. These guys, the floor is yours.
Thanks. So let me share my slides. Perfect. Okay, hi everyone. Thanks for having accepted our work. Thanks, Tala. Yes, our work is quantum advantage seeker with the kernels. We are two PhD students, two researchers that work in this beautiful field called quantum machine learning. We don't know which is your background, so we try to keep it as general as possible. And basically, what will be this talk is the first part where I will explain all the background that you need to have a project in quantum machine learning. And then Massimiliano will explain how we developed a software, a tool that is called Qwask, which helps you in basically skipping all this background knowledge and being aware of it. It will facilitate a lot your work. So we can start with what is in classical machine learning, a classification problem. And if we have a data set of n data points, and each of these data points have n features, then you can imagine that these data points are represented in a space, and we can find a plane in this space, which separates these two data set, these two cluster of data points. And each data point could belong to a different class. So our task is to classify to which class these data points belong. And in our trivial example, you can see in this plot there are yellow crosses and blue crosses. But how to separate these two clusters of data points is not trivial. So there is not a unique solution. And what is the optimal separation can be defined according to a test. Also, what is the goal of our algorithm? So if we want to test new data points without knowing their label, they could fall in different parts of our plot. So if we didn't choose an optimal separation, we could misclassify the data points. For example, if we take this upper line and a yellow cross falls here, that will be misclassified. So how can we find the optimal separation? Well, this is given by a famous algorithm, which is called the Sapir vector machine. And this is the formula which give us the optimal hyperplane in a mathematical way. And what the goal would be is to find a hyperplane which maximize the margin between the closest data points of each class. And these data points, which defines the margin and also the hyperplane, are called indeed the Sapir vectors. In this setup, it is all very simple, and it is called the hard margin problem. But there are some problems which are more difficult, where we cannot find these margins in this way, but we have to allow data points to fall within the margins. And this will give us an error, actually, a finite error, but will improve our generalization power. I'm taking for granted that you know what is the generalization error, but sorry for that. This parameter C is what basically regulates how many data points we want them to fall within the margins. So regulating this parameter, which is indeed called the regularization parameter, we can have a trade-off between overfitting and underfitting of our model. So we will be more or less able to classify our test data points correctly. And this parameter, then it is very important to somehow understand what is the predictive power of our algorithm. And indeed, this is, it is also present in one of the metrics we use in our package Quask. This that you saw is a very trivial case, but sometimes, and I would say most of the time, the dataset is not trivial at all, and the data points are not linearly separable. So what you need is a tool that is called the feature map, which will map your data into a high dimensional space, which separates linearly your data points. And this is called the feature space. So you can start to see that when the data points are close, then they belong to the same class. And when the data points are far, they belong to different classes. So this is given by the inner product, by the distance of the two data points. And the inner product in the feature space is given by the inner product of these two functions. So as you can see here, phi xi, phi s. And this is actually the definition of a kernel. So we can use this kernel then to solve our supervector machine algorithm to find the optimal hyperplane. This concept of feature map and feature space can be transposed perfectly in quantum computation. And indeed, when the system is not linear, we can use a feature map to map the data points into the quantum feature space. That is represented here by a generalized block sphere, but the concept is exactly the same. So when you want to find this quantum kernel, what you have to do is to embed the data points to define the feature map. For example, this is a circuit encoding the data point X, and then taking also a circuit encoding the data point Z, we get the inner product of these two feature maps. And then, as I already said, for the classical case, you take this quantum kernel and you can compute the classical SVM finding the space, finding the optimal hyperplane in the space, in the feature space. And this, if you followed so far, or you already know quantum kernels, then you start to build this intuition that it is very important the relative distance of data points in the feature space. And this is given strictly by the feature map that you choose. So in the quantum space, what you have is that when your feature map is very complicated, then the data gets sparser in the Hilbert space, the quantum Hilbert space, as you can see here. So when you compute the overlap between two data points, you will have always smaller results, making it difficult to understand if they belong to the same class or not. So what you need is metrics. There are classical metrics, quantum metrics. I will start saying that the classical metrics, at least the one implemented in Quask, then you can extend this, are the kernel polarity and the kernel target alignment. And these metrics are based on the concept that if you are able to learn the target function, which defines the label or your data sets, because you are in this supervised machine learning case, then you can expect that an ideal kernel matrix would be given by this product here of the labels yi, yj. So what you can do is to compute the inner product between this ideal kernel matrix and your real kernel matrix. And the formula here of the polarity is what I already said. The kernel target alignment is simply a normalized version of this. In the same fashion, in quantum, you can define very similar matrices. So still the geometry is the key here to understand the power of our models. And what they do, what is in Qwask is are quantum metrics that were defined already 2 years ago in this paper of Wang called The Power of Data in Quantum Machine Learning. And what they do is to create metrics which compare not the quantum kernel feature space itself, but compares the classical and the quantum feature spaces. So the one generated by our classical and quantum kernels. So if you have that these two spaces are very similar, then you don't expect the quantum kernel to perform well or better than the classical. While if there is a large geometric difference between these two quantum and classical feature spaces, then you will have maybe a quantum advantage. And to class and to confirm or exclude it, you can integrate also in this matrix the labels with this other metric called the model complexity. So as in the kernel target alignment, you use the label to understand what is the real efficiency of our model. Indeed, in Qwask, then you can find a very large library of quantum kernels. And we implemented also other quantum kernels. One is structured learning implemented by Massimiliano and the other projected kernels by me, which are quantum kernels that can somehow go beyond the problems that you find with the quantum kernels, with the traditional, if we can call traditional quantum kernels. And for example, the one that I told you, so the space, the Hilbert space becomes very large, and so you have difficulty in understanding the classes. Then with the structured learning and projected kernels, both are methods to have a limited expressibility of these quantum kernels, but still that are very hard to simulate classically, so that we can achieve some advantage with respect to the classical counterpart. Of course, this is not a limited list, and we will add more quantum kernels in our package. And now I will give this presentation to Massimiliano. So I'll stop sharing and he will go.
Thank you very much, Francesco. Can you see me?
Yes, we can.
Okay,
see.
Thank you
and
very much.
Hear you. Yes.
As you can see, we have a lot of aspects that we need to take care on when we work with quantum kernels. What we want to do is really create a software that can help scientists to avoid taking care of all these useless aspects that maybe. That maybe take you a lot of time, but gives you no real result. So we can take away the boilerplate part of this process. And in particular, in doing that, we need to know which is the purpose of the scientist. So for example, a scientist might want to test a specific task with quantum kernels and see if he or she has an advantage. Or maybe if you are a theoretical computer scientist, you can maybe define an algorithm based on quantum kernel and you want to see if it works experimentally on some task. Maybe you can also want to prove theoretically if this task work. You have also to consider the problem of quantum kernel that are mostly expressibility control issue. So you can get a very expressible quantum kernel that does not generalize, and you might want to compare all these expressibility control techniques. Moreover, if you use a synthetic benchmark, you can expect your data to be clean, so ready to be used by your machine learning model. But if you use real-world data, you also have to perform pre-processing, so get your data in an equivalent format, easier to process. And there are different techniques to do that. And also, most importantly, you might not have a background in computer science, and you might not be able to create easily a software that integrates quantum kernel within a machine learning pipeline. So what can we do to really automatize this process? We have identified a pipeline of steps that any scientist that works with quantum kernel has to follow. The first step is to generate your data, which might mean just load it from an already existing dataset, or you might want to generate it with a certain process, a Monte Carlo process or something else. It might represent either classical or quantum data. Then you have the preprocessing phase, in which you do data cleanizing and everything. After that, you select and create kernel matrices from your data. These kernel matrices can be created using a classical kernel or a quantum kernel. You might want to compare them. You might want to run analysis on them, such as their eigendecomposition to study something. And then finally, you use them within a classifier of your choice, and then you can run analysis and plot results. And with our software Quask, we want to automatize this pipeline so that everything can run all these steps smoothly without any effort, without any knowledge of software development at this level. Quask can be used in two ways. The easiest way is through its command line interface. So you just install the Python program that is Quask, and you can, with your terminal, just run some easy and well-documented command that generates all the dataset. As you can see, you can choose the dataset according to the thing you want to solve. If you want to solve a regression problem and you want to just consider quantum data, you might want to generate this dataset that is based on MNIST, which is an image dataset. And after that, you get your data in ready to be read form. Then you might want to preprocess the dataset, and we have collected all the preprocessing technique we could think of. And then this command line interface will guide you in creating the prepared alternative dataset, that is the dataset you generated before, but just preprocessed. after that, you will certainly create some kernel grammatices, and we have already implemented some both classical and quantum kernel technique to create these grammatices. And furthermore, you can decide to have what we call the fixed kernel, so already well defined with a concrete definition, or you can have like trainable kernel that just are sort of parametric kernel whose parameter can be decided accordingly to some optimization process. at the end of this phase, you can use these matrices to create your classifier and then plot the result of some analysis accordingly to the metric you want. So you might want to test the accuracy, but you might want also to test different metrics that gives you different insights on your data. And this is a very static show because time is short, but you can also go to our website and download the software and try it yourself. It's important to know. Yes, please.
Please be aware that your time is
18
over,
minutes,
so
right?
Please.
Yeah, 1 minute.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. But I've concluded. It's you have to be aware that the Quask software is built on top of different quantum computing frameworks, and for that you can also use Quask with different frameworks. So we based everything on Pendulum, but you can switch easily to Qiskit. And that allows you also to use Qiskit in a different way, so to integrate it in an already existing code without using the command line interface, And that really allows you to keep the code you have already wrote if you have already wrote something. So you have these two ways of using the software, one that requires you zero code and is very easy to learn, and this software API structure that can be integrated with an already existing software and makes your work perhaps easier because we already have implemented something. Said that, thank you very much for inviting us again. And this is our article. And if you want, if you have any more questions, you can text us. We will be very, very happy. Thank you again.
Great. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Massimiliano. Thank you, Francesco. Amazing talk. Amazing tool.
Thanks.
I will try to pick up one question maybe from the chat, but before that, I will suggest you guys to share on Discord some links and some basic comments about at least the installation and running of your software. So the talk will be easy recorded and will be online soon. But meantime, you can share it on Discord. Maybe some people would like to get in touch with you, or also to get hands-on on your software. Okay, one basic question from the chat. Could you explain the concept of kernel, both quantum and classical?
Yeah, sure. Yes, I can go. A kernel technique can generalize the notion of inner product. You can definitely use an inner product calculated by a classical program, which is a classical kernel. Then if you then want to calculate this inner product by embedding your data in the Hilbert space of a quantum system and then taking the inner product within the quantum system, then you are creating a quantum kernel. And you can get a reference here in the paper of Havlicek that introduced this technique.
Great. One more question, very quickly, please, Massimiliano. Has there been benchmark on using different quantum kernels on some data set? And can we get these circuits out of it?
Yeah, absolutely. You can also see the work of the thesis of Francesco that, analyzed a certain data set in LHC. If you want, we can also chat on Discord about that.
Yes. Yes, sure. We can. We are available on to talk about this.
There are a lot of benchmarks in the literature.
Thank you very much. Great. Thanks for the answer. With that, I would like to thank again Massimiliano and Francesco. Thank you very much, guys, for being here. Thank you for the amazing talk, for the amazing tool.